Greetings to all you wonderful souls in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And as I said before, I'm going to be speaking about basically if a prophet prophesy and the prophecy does not come to pass, does that mean the prophet is a false prophet? Now, I'm not going to be speaking based on my own point of view, but I'm going to use four biblical accounts. I'm going to go through them. Two of the four of them are really strong in answering this particular question, right? So before I do that, I'm going to share the live and then I will start. Beautiful souls and people, thank you for joining the live. As I said before, today's message is going to be answering the question that you all see there. If a prophecy does not come to pass, does that make the prophet a false prophet, right? Okay, so there are going to be four different biblical accounts I'm going to use. I'm going to tell you all, the first one is not going to be the strongest. Based on my pick, I would think that the second biblical account I will give and the last one, those may be the best two, but I'm giving four regardless, okay? So the first one is going to be taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 2, verses 16 and 17, right? So I'm going to read Genesis chapter 2, verses 16 and 17. Now this is the first biblical account, right? Okay, verse 16 says, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. So basically God gave Adam a command there, and he also said, if you eat of the tree of good of, which is good and evil, knowing good and evil, you will surely die, right? So basically that was an order command from God, right? And if we read now verses 22 in Genesis chapter 3, we will see that, and the Lord God said, behold, a man is become as one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. And then God said, therefore, the Lord sent him forth out of the garden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So basically, this promise and command came like directly from God to Adam, right? Because of course Adam was the first man, or his wife and so forth. And they both end up, those of us who know the story know that they both end up breaking God's command, his order. And as a result, all of us humans now basically have to die one day. That's how the death came in. And if again, the same verse I just read in Genesis chapter 3 verse 22 tells us, God was saying that least he put forth his hand, speak about Adam, and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. So you see that we were created to live forever based on that verse alone. Live forever, God had to drive them out, send them out of the garden, right? Because then if they went and ate of that tree after they ate from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and having that penalty of death upon their lives, now they will be living forever. And then you see how evil and wicked this world is. Everybody from whatever the world started would have been living, and it would have been like, I don't know, it would have been like so unbelievable or scary in the sense that people killing you or trying to kill you and you can't die, or people injuring you, or like these kind of things and you can't die. It would have been a really, really scary world to live in for a man. But that is not what I want to focus on, right? So there are times, based on this particular account, is that God will give us a promise. Well, this was directly from God. And if we obey his promise, we will receive the particular promise. In this case, it would have been life to live on this earth. Since Adam and Eve broke that promise, they got what God warned them of. You would surely die, which is what we all have to pass through one day. Once you are born, you will die one day. Okay, so going on now to the second one. Now, this biblical account will give you all a better idea as if a prophecy, as in a prophet prophesied something, was it directly from God? Because, you know, sometimes prophets, of course, you know, they are false prophets and real prophets. And one thing I can tell you, the Bible never said you were not a prophet by the prophecy. So, but you would know them by their fruits. And the fruits is living according to the fruits of the Spirit, the word of God, what God commands us, how God commands us to live. So, going to Exodus chapter 3 verses 8, right? Exodus chapter 3 verses 8 tells us, and I came down, this was God speaking to Moses, right, to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land unto a good land and a large land, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, right? So this was basically a promise. God was relating this message to Moses that he came to deliver his people the Israelites out of Egypt. That was one part. And the second part was for them to go into a land of milk and honey. So this was a prophecy, and this prophecy, God was giving it to Moses, right? Directly to Moses. So first of all, knowing that it was directly from God, of course, is not a false prophecy, right? Secondly, I want to read Exodus chapter 5 verses 49. I can't go through the entire scripture. I'm putting out specific scriptures, and I will explain certain things as I go along, right? So Exodus chapter 5 verses 49 tells us, "And the king of Egypt said unto them," that is Pharaoh said unto Moses, right? "Wherefore do ye, Moses and Aaron, let the people from their work get you onto your burden." So basically, this is when Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh to give, to ask or command Pharaoh, or request of Pharaoh, that God wanted his people to go in the wilderness to sacrifice, right? That was the process, or what God told them to do in order to get the people out of Egypt, right? So that's when they went and speak to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh was saying that they wanted to let go the people of their burden of their work, right? And Pharaoh said in verse 5, "Behold, the people of the land now are many, and he made them rest from their burdens. And Pharaoh commanded the same day the taskmasters of the people and the officers, saying, he shall no more give the people straw to make brick, as heretofore, let them go and gather straw for themselves. And the tally of the bricks which they did make heretofore, he shall lay upon them, and he shall not diminish or deal," meaning that they should not make less, right? "For they be idle, therefore they cry, saying, let us go and sacrifice to our God. Let there more work be laid upon the men, that they may labor therein, and let them not regard their vain words." So you see, I previously just read the prophecy that God gave to Moses, that he's going to deliver his people and carry them to a land flowing with milk and honey. Now, when confronted with the enemy, Aaron and Moses confront the enemy about taking the people, freeing the people, who was Pharaoh. Pharaoh now decided to make it harder for the people. So what a lot of people don't understand, not because you get a prophecy from God means things going to be easy, is now when the enemy is going to come at you more than ever. He's good, because the enemy does not want none of us to have anything good in his life, right? So he put more burden. He stopped giving people straw, so they had to go and find their own straw, and they were also requested to make sure that they made the same tally of bricks. So not because, again, I'm saying you get a prophecy, you mean that it's going to come easy. The enemy, the devil, Satan, and all his evil workers, the people who work on his behalf, are going to be fighting you down. Trust me, right? That is why it is always important. A lot of believers don't do these things, to be praying fast and spending time with God, because it is a warfare thing. Going on, I'm going to read verses 23, same as Exodus chapter 5, right? It says, "For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in thy name, he had done evil to this people, neither has he delivered thy people at all." So this is Moses now speaking to God and saying, God, in other words, you gave me a promise to the, you're going to deliver your people out of Egypt. And also they go into a land flowing with milk and honey. But since I came and speak to Pharaoh about this, he has basically made it more hard for the people. And you, God, has not delivered the people. So are you going to say that God is a liar? No. You see, God allowed that to happen for a specific purpose. Once God already said he's going to do something, God is faithful to his word. Right? And you know, I'm telling you, even I, when I receive prophecies, sometimes I just wish it could happen right away, right? But that is not always the case. Most of the time, that is not the case, right? So going on now to Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 68. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verses 6 to 8 is saying, the Lord our God spake unto us in Horeb, saying, ye have dwelt long enough in this mount, right? So God speaking to the children of Israel. Turn you and take your journey and go to the mount of the Amorites and unto all the places near thereunto in the plain, in the hills, in the vale, in the south, and by the sea to the land of the Canaanites, and unto Lebanon, and unto the great river, the river Euphrates, right? Verses 8, behold, I have set the land before you. Go in, possess the land which the Lord spare unto your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give unto them and to their seed after them. Now, for those who were there before, I just spoke firstly about God promise, give Moses the promise or the prophecy that he's going to deliver his people out of Egypt. And he is also going to, they're going to go to a land flow with milk and honey. Then after that, when Moses and Aaron went to confront Pharaoh to get the people out of the hands of Pharaoh for him to free them, Pharaoh now put more burden on the people. And then Moses went back to go and say, I went to Pharaoh, he made things hard for me after you sent me and you have not even delivered the people. Right? And basically, now I'm reading that this is Deuteronomy. Now it's after the people of Israel were brought out of that captivity. It took some time, but God did do it, right? And God is telling the people now, go into the land, possess the land, you know, the lands before you that have been promised to your forefathers, right? Now, verses 22 in the same Deuteronomy chapter 21 it says, behold, the Lord thy God has set the land before thee. Go up and possess it as the Lord God of thy fathers has said unto thee. Fear not, neither be discouraged. So God again is telling people, go up, take the land, do not be discouraged, do not fear. And that's another thing a lot of Christians sometimes, we, I like to say we, which includes me sometimes, we allow fear to get in our way, but we have to not allow fear to get in our way, because God said he has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. So after that, God spoke again for them to go there, to take the land, to possess the land. Verses 26, same Deuteronomy chapter 1, is saying, notwithstanding, he would not go up, but rebelled against the commandment of your God. So they didn't listen. The children of Israel, they rebelled and they did not go up. They did not go and possess the land, the same land that God promised them, right? Because they were, as I continue to read, you'll see why. Verses 27, and he murmured in your tents and said, behold, so sorry, because the Lord hated us, he has brought us forth out of the land of Egypt to deliver us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us. So from God delivering, promising to deliver the people, he also promised that they go to this land with milk and honey. Then Pharaoh tried to block it. Pharaoh gave them pressure. Now the people, God commanded them after he took them out of there to go and possess the land. Still, now they blaming God and saying God hate them. Moving, right? Verses 28 says, whither shall we go up? Our brethren have discouraged our hearts, saying the people is greater and taller than we. The cities are great and walled up to heaven. And moreover, we have seen the sons of the Anakims there. So the people were afraid and they're telling what they see. God telling you how to go, but you're fearful because of what you see. right? Verses 29 to 33 says, then I said unto you, dread not, neither be afraid of them. The Lord your God which goeth before you, he shall fight for you according to all that he did for you in Egypt before your eyes. And in the wilderness where thou hast seen how the Lord thy God bare thee as a man doth bear his son in all the way that he went until he came into this place. Yet in this thing he did not believe the Lord your God, who went in the way before you to search you out a place to pitch your tent in fire by night, to show you by what what way he should go, and in a cloud by day. So now, after God commanded people to go into the land, they are fearful, they're not going. Now look at what happens, right? In verses 35, surely there shall not one of these men of this evil generation see that good land which I swear to give to your fathers. So now the people of Israel who came out of Egypt did not get to see the land that God promised them. God promised them through his servant Moses. And as I read previously, you would know why they didn't get to see the land. God told them to go after he brought them out of Egypt. And if you read Deuteronomy chapter 1, they never went because they were afraid. They studying all the giants they were seeing, and they're afraid of this one and that one. And as a result, they know God stopped them or blocked them. In other words, this promise is no longer going to come to pass in terms of you. Right? Now, I'm going to continue reading verses 39. It says, moreover, your little ones, which he said should be prey, and your children, which in that day had no knowledge between good and evil, they shall go in thither. And unto them will I give it, and they shall possess it. So, you see, they didn't get to go in because of their rebellion. It was not because it was a false prophecy. It was because of their rebellion, but their children got to go in. Right? God made that promise that their children would go in. Verses 40 to 42 now says, but as for you, turn you and take your journey into the wilderness by the way of the Red Sea. Then he answered and said unto me, we have sinned against the Lord. We shall go up and fight according to all that the Lord our God commanded us. And when we have girded on every man his weapon of war, he were ready to go up into the hill. And the Lord said unto me, say unto them, go not up, neither fight, for I am not among you, lest ye be smitten before your enemies. So now the people want to go. After they rebel against God, after they were faithful, they were not listening to God, they didn't want to go. Now they no longer get in to go to the promised land. All of a sudden they want to go. It's too late. Alright? So this was not a false prophecy. It was due to the people's rebellion, their fear, right? Fear because of the giants and the people of the other nations that they missed out, right? Okay, now I'm going on to another one. I'm going to read 1 Kings chapter 9, verses 47. Yes, 1 Kings chapter 9, verses 47. Whoa, 47. I think I read, what did I write here? I have no 47 here. That's not. Okay. 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 1. No. I think I made a mistake. I tried to change around. And some mistake I made in my writing here. Let me see. 47. Can't figure out what verse was that. But Okay, so there was a verse, basically, I'm trying to recall it, where, okay, 1 Kings chapter 9, verses 3, right? It says, and the Lord said unto him, that Solomon, God speaking to, I have heard thy prayer and thy supplication that thou hast made before me. I have hallowed thy house, which thou hast built to put my name there forever, and my eyes and my ears have, shall be there perpetually. And if thou wilt walk before me, as David thy father walked in integrity of heart, in uprightness, to do according to all as I have commanded thee, I will keep my statutes and my judgments, and I will establish the throne of thy kingdom upon Israel forever, as I promised to David thy father, saying, there shall not fail thee a man upon the throne of Israel. But if he shall at all turn from following me, he or your children, and will not keep my commandments and my statutes, which I have set before you, but go and serve other gods and worship them, then will I cut off Israel out of the land which I have given them, and this house which I have hallowed for my name will I cast out of my sight, and Israel shall be a proverb and a byword among all people. So God spoke to Solomon. He actually got two sides of it. The first one was what God will do to his kingdom, the good thing that God will do to his kingdom once he stayed faithful and obeyed God, and what God will do to him and his kingdom, his family, his children, if he falls away from God and goes to strange gods. So verses chapter 11, First Kings, verses 1 to 4, this is what happened. But King Solomon loved many strange women, together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonians, and Hittites, of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go into them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your hearts after their gods. Solomon clave unto these in love. And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines. And his wives turned away his heart. For it came to pass when Solomon was old, and his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of his father. So Solomon fell away. And as a result, he was one before actually. He was given both. If the good consequence and the bad consequence of his actions, if he did, which one, right? And verses 6, 9 to 12, verses 6 says, and Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord, and went not fully after the Lord as did David his father. Verses 9, and the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned from the Lord God of Israel, which had appeared unto him twice. And he commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods, but he kept not that which the Lord commanded. Wherefore the Lord said to Solomon, for as much as this is done of thee, and thou hast not kept my commandment and my statutes, which I have commanded thee, I will surely rend the kingdom from you and will give it to thy servant. Notwithstanding, in thy days I will not do it for David thy father's sake, but I will rend it from the hand of your son. So you see, when God promised us stuff, that's why a lot of people, some people tend to be ignorant to the will of God, meaning they don't care to learn and to understand. But a lot of times when God promises us things, it does be under conditions, right? And if we don't live according to the will of God, if we don't maintain our lifestyle, then we end up losing out. Once we maintain, we obey God, God will continue to increase us, so give us everything that He has in store for us, right? And finally, this one is the best one of them all. I'm going to the book of Jonah, chapter 1. Jonah is one of the best stories, right? If you have to answer the question, if a prophecy does not come to pass, is that prophet a false prophet? Right? So Jonah chapter 1 verses 4 said, sorry, verses 1 to 4. Now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord, and went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare thereof, and went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent a great wind into the sea, and there was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. So basically, God spoke to Jonah to him to go to Nineveh, preach to the people. And Jonah ran away from God, right? He tried to run away technically. That way, you really can't run from God. You could go underground. Doesn't matter where you go, God is still going to see you, right? So I don't know what kind of man Jonah was, but only God knew. So now I'm going to read Jonah chapter 3, verses 4 to 6. It says, and Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey. So that's after Jonah ran away. He was, the sea became rough, and then basically, was in which verse, boy? Verses 15, I think. So they took up Jonah and cast him forth into the sea, and the sea ceased from raging. So Jonah ran away from God. God caused the sea to have a serious storm. It was really bad. And then eventually Jonah told him to throw him overboard because it was his fault. He knew it was God was in that, what was going on there, right? Because God was really after Jonah, because God wanted Jonah to do what God said, right? And as I'm now reading in Jonah chapter 3, verses 4, 5, 6 says, this is after God gave Jonah another chance to go to Nineveh after he ran away the first time. And Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey, and he cried and said, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So the people of Nineveh believed God, and proclaim a fast, and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them even to the least of them. For word came that the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his robe from him and covered him with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Right, I'm going to Jonah chapter 3 further along, verses 9 to 10, right? So basically after Jonah actually obeyed God, and he went and spoke to the people, and the people of Nineveh, the king, they humbled themselves. Verses 9 and 10 tells us that who can tell if God will this is Jonah speaking here, right? Who can tell if God will turn and repent and turn away from his fierce anger that we perish not? Sorry, this was not Jonah, this was the people of Nineveh. And God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. And that's what Jonah didn't want, as I'm going to read now. Jonah chapter 4 verses 1 and 2. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was very angry. And he prayed unto the Lord and said, I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my sin when I was yet in my country? Therefore I fled before unto Tarshish. For I knew that thou art a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, of great kindness, and repentest thee of the evil. So Jonah was very upset that God that God repented and did not destroy Nineveh because the people repented. Now people say that if Jonah was a modern day prophet and Jonah was telling us God's going to destroy Nineveh, he sent me to preach in Nineveh. He went to Nineveh. We didn't see Nineveh destroyed. We'd have probably taught in our minds. Some people have absolutely no cover for them, but they might have said Jonah is a false prophet. Jonah was not a false prophet. You know, God does not want to destroy people. But since the people humble themselves and they repented and so forth, God changed his mind concerning destroying Nineveh. And that's how the prophecy of the destruction of Nineveh did not come to pass. Right, so now, based on the question that I have there as my description or the title of this live, is it possible, basically, that if a prophecy does not come to pass, is the prophet's fault? Now, the only way or two ways that you could actually be able to know that is based on these two things. One, reading the word of God. So you always have to test what a prophet is saying against the word of God. No, there's not everything you could test. And you know why I'm saying this? Because I've had prophets test prophesy to me things about me not written in the Bible. Right, so when prophets come to tell me things about me as not in the Bible, because of course my life is not written in the Bible, that is when you have to go to God and acknowledge God. So to really know if a prophet is true, if they prophesy something and did not come to pass, it's either you test it against the word, you ask God to either show you a scripture to confirm this. If God didn't show you a scripture, the only other alternative is to ask God to confirm, is this prophet a false prophet? Was this a lying prophecy? Is it that it did not come to pass because something happened that caused you, God, to change your mind? Because it's possible based on the story of Jonah that I just gave you there, and also what happened with the children of Israel when God told them to go and possess the land that I went through earlier on, and they did not go, and God said you all are not going into the land anymore. So those are the only two main ways you will be able to tell if the prophet is really. But there is possibilities that prophecies to will not come to pass, either because the person did not obey or maintain a life in Christ, and that could cause the prophecy not to come to pass, or the person did maintain a lifestyle in Christ and the prophecy came to pass. If there are many different things, right? That's why the Bible never said you will know a prophet by their prophecy. It says you will know them by their fruits. It didn't specifically say prophets, but ministers in general, you know them by their fruit. You know them by their fruit, right? So you have a blessed one. I hope that this word would have helped those that are desirous. Take care.